The following program is intended for mature audiences. Listener discretion is advised. The views expressed are those of the panelists and not necessarily those of the sponsors, Broadway Media, or any school district, their respective managements or employees.
Oh, Geek Show Podcast, welcome to it. This is a special, I call it a one-off, because usually when we sit down to record, we'll record three episodes right in a row, you know. That's where we get the third show chant from. This one, the math didn't work out where we could do three shows before our live shows at Comic-Con this coming weekend, FanX in Salt Lake City. So what we're going to do is we sat down on a Friday night and we pounded one out, for lack of a better term. Jay couldn't make it. He was doing a comedy show. But the rest of us are here. And I just want to remind you one more time about our events that are happening this weekend. If you're attending FanX in Salt Lake City, on Friday the 17th, we'll be doing a show live at 3 p.m. in room 150G, as in Gary. So that's 3 p.m. room 150G on Friday. Then that Saturday night, the 18th, go to Club 50 West. It's at 50 West and Broadway in downtown Salt Lake. It's like a block away from the Salt Palace. You can stumble there with no problem. And the doors open at 7. The show will start promptly at 8, maybe even a little bit more before 8, because we did it. We're going to all, on the big screen at 50 West, watch Raiders of the Lost Ark for the very first time with Jay. I know the rest of us have seen it. He has not. And so we're going to... this will be a bad experience for him, I think. We're going to... all of us have microphones. We're all going to riff the movie. And if that is listenable, then we'll put that out in podcast form in the future. Only if it's listenable. So that, and that's a free event, by the way, 21 and older, because they got a bar and you can get food there. It is doors at 7, starts at 8, 50 West Broadway in downtown Salt Lake City. It's Club 50 West on Saturday the 18th. Hope you're there. It's free. I mean, why not? The drinks and the food are not. The entrances. That's what I mean. Okay. All right. I want to thank our sponsors for making this show possible. Dr. Volt's Comet Connection opens 7 days a week. Their hold service is free, and with that, you get a discount of 10% off purchases of $20 or more, and you get the previews catalog for free. 2043 East, 3300 South in Salt Lake City, it's Dr. Volt's Comet Connection. So I want to thank Dave at Cabin Fever, located in the heart of Trolley Square on the corner of 5th South and 7th East in Salt Lake. Cabin Fever has been helping the meek, the geek, and the freak since day one. So much more than a card store. It's Cabin Fever. Also want to thank Chef Daniel Cantu, home delivery service geared for those who can't cook, won't cook, or are too busy. And if you're having ingredients sent to your house and you're doing all the work, you're a sucker. And, you know, all that packaging can't be good for the environment, right? Let Daniel do it. Go to his website, www.cantuscatering.com. That's C-A-N-T-U-S catering.com for more information. And talk to him about that. Also want to thank Dawn and Leah at Black Velvet Boutique at 293 South State Street in Clearfield. Open 7 days a week, blackvelvetboutique.com. You can call them at 801-525-1583 if you'd like. It's not a porn store or a novelty store. It's a store for grown-ups who enjoy or want to enjoy sex. Black Velvet Boutique. Also want to thank FanX. SaltLakeComicCon.com is the website to get your tickets. Salt Lake Comic Con presents FanX 2017, March 17th and 18th at the Salt Palace Convention Center. You got merchandise vendors there. Stan Lee's going to show up. Jason Momoa. You've got Weird Al Yankovic coming. And us, of course. We'll be there as well. Get the full lineup and purchase your pass today at SaltLakeComicCon.com. And be sure to join us for our events revolving around FanX. All right. Let's get to the episode. Name of it is Get In My Belly. Pleased to enjoy. Let the Trek bashing begin.
Who would have ever thought that Shannon would be the grounded one?
My boys actually swim a little bit too good.
We've learned about grammar and plagiarism.
I've got it.
Blueberry. Oh, yeah. Eat show, eat
show. Feel paralyzed. It's all and it's
biting leads to sex.
Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me.
Do you have gills? Do you know anybody with gills?
Kevin Costner.
You contrarian son of a bitch.
We're back to this.
GeekShowPodcast.com.
And welcome to the basement.
Oh,
woo!
God.
This is my fault. I apologize.
Yeah.
This is
a Friday night recording.
Friday night
magic!
So,
yeah. It's my fault. Yeah. I apologize.
And Friday night's date night in my house. Hey, honey.
Oh, hi.
Oh, wow. This is weird.
That just got awfully.
Wow, chicka wow now.
You guys are all on our date right now.
Oh, gross.
Cool.
All right. Well, they're married.
It's just going to get weird.
They're married. Nothing's happening.
I'll lick you if you lick me.
Cool.
Cool.
All right, we're pairing off. That leaves Lee and Carrie.
So we had to do one episode before
the magic.
The magic at Fan X.
Yeah. This, and 50 West.
This coming weekend.
It's going to get nuts.
Is it?
Yeah.
Please.
Well, it's so fucked up.
Explain to me how it's going to get nuts.
These.
Have you been there? Yes, you have.
Yeah.
The people that ran it, they scheduled on St. Patrick's Day weekend.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they're actually, usually they do the parade the weekend before St. Patrick's Day. But no, this year they're like, let's do it on the actual St. Patrick's Day weekend. So I am so doubly fucked, you guys.
I don't think you're doubly fucked. What I'm excited
I'm going to have to control myself.
And
Irish infant for fucking 2 days.
I don't think you're going to control yourself because you're doing a panel, which I am very excited to see, with the one and only Vern Troyer.
You got that one?
Yeah.
Oh, you poor son of a bitch.
Now listen, right? So here's the thing.
He is a fucking handful.
So am I. So I think we might challenge each other.
Might pick him up in his hands.
I cannot wait for the news conference about the St. Patrick's Day parade that Shannon and Vern Troyer lead.
Doesn't he use a motorized...
Yeah. Well, here's the thing.
The batteries out.
I said that Shannon should have jazzy races around.
Yeah, just take the batteries out and he'll be fine.
My thing with him is at 7 o'clock at night.
On what, Friday?
On actual St. Patrick's Day. Yeah. So I'm like, I'm going to have to rein it in. Well, I have to rein it all day because that's the only day I have stuff going on, right? And I'm just like, and then I'm sitting there going, what the fuck?
No, wait, what day is it?
It's that's Friday
or Saturday.
Friday.
Oh, okay. All right.
But the parade's on Saturday, right?
The parade's on Saturday. I have nothing on Saturday.
But technically, St. Patrick's Day is Friday.
Right. So my thing is like, one, what the hell do I talk to Vern Troyer about for an hour?
Austin Powers.
All the things I want to talk to him about, he probably doesn't want to talk about.
Yeah. Like his giant dick and how he pissed in that closet that one time.
Nearly on an electrical outlet.
Yeah,
I have the recording of that.
Yeah. Right? And then also...
It's actually my ringtone.
It could be.
I am interviewing America's most famous tiny person that's still alive.
Yeah.
On St. Patrick's Day, how do I not ask him if somebody tried to get his gold?
Oh, no.
Oh.
Right? And it's like, I just...
You better leave your net at home.
It's just such a tenuous...
Let me tell you how you do that, Shannon. You just don't.
Well, I won't, but I want to, bad me in the back is going to be screaming hard.
Would you like me to bust into the middle of it and say, where's your gold?
Get over here. Actually, I'd like Tony to do it because he's more...
Ah, where is your gold? over here!
And you need to at one point say, and you won't be distracting me with cereal this time, you bloody git.
I guess I was doing Scottish. I need to switch to Irish.
Yes, Irish.
But the best thing is, so I put out a thing, right? I was like, so you ever want to see me have a conversation with Vern Troyer? Because that's something that's happening next Friday, you know? And... God, who was
he's it? He's not real chatty, I'll warn you.
Oh, I fucking know.
Yeah.
And do you think that Shannon could sit there and just talk to himself for,
I probably
for
could.
30 minutes? Yeah. He'll be fine.
I'd say so.
Andy Wilson, our friend Andy Wilson, goes, wild card versus wild card.
Yeah.
And then Ryan Call from Comic-Con, commented on that with an arrow pointing up, like, this guy gets it. So... Yeah, that's happening.
I'll give you $5 if you tell him to get in your belly.
I was going to get a hat made, but, but I'm not.
Get in my belly! Yeah! That's it.
God, I hope he doesn't listen to this. Be nice to me, you tiny little fucker.
I think he's the one that left the and Shannon participates comment.
Yeah,
I think you should do what I did with Carrie Elwes when I was like, I don't want to talk about Princess Bride. Which is like his gold. Right. And I was like, I just want to talk about Days of Thunder.
What's it like being a bite-sized human?
Now, see, I've been assigned to do the Princess Bride reunion.
Uh-huh. I think yours is going to be fun.
I think yours is,
if
too.
They need me. I mean, there's things that y'all don't know about this. When we're assigned to these celebrity panels, sometimes, like the last one I did, Michael Rooker, I was assigned Michael Rooker. I got there and he goes, I got this. I got this. And he, okay, fine, and he great.
Yeah. But I think, like, I feel like I'm going to be, it's going to be like, I'm going to be dragging Vern Troyer through this thing, right? Because he doesn't seem to
he's
like these things
chatty.
Very much.
No, he's not chatty. Hmm.
Oh, God damn it.
It's going to be a tough one. I won't lie to you.
So this is like my, this is my trial by fire.
Yes. This is going to be a tough one. I would not, be honest with you, if they'd approached me and said, do you want to do it? Well, I would have said, not really.
Jimmy, I was talking to you. I was like, oh, fucking no.
Shannon, this seems like it could be, it's like your greatest dream, but also your worst nightmare at the same time.
I told Shannon that day, I go, this is going to be the greatest panel of all time or a fucking disaster.
Yeah. Kind of sums up my life, right? So, I'm...
Hi. Let's introduce the panel.
Who are we?
He's Vern Troyer's new friend. He's Shannon Barneson, everybody.
So, hey, you were in an several Austin Powers movies.
Like two, I think.
Hey, just like that.
He's cool.
He did a Harry Potter?
He was in a Harry Potter. I got to watch that, I guess.
He was in one of them. He was in one of them.
Yeah,
it
wasn't Warwick?
He was at like
no, it was
Warwick was in.
Warwick was in.
He was
no, no, no.
He was the professor.
He was in
Professor
Harry Potter.
Plant guy.
Professor Flit.
Yeah.
Flitwick.
Yeah. And we looked it up. He was in an episode of Shasta McNasty.
All good.
What was it like working on Shasta McNasty? Anyway,
you'll be fine.
I know I'll be okay.
It was
but
just another job for me.
I just put it on as a lark because we get this. I put him on as a lark. I was like.
You were the only one.
Probably.
I think, because what happened.
I guarantee you, no matter how poorly it goes, it'll still be better than my Baby Boba Fett interview.
Yeah.
Because you didn't show up.
You didn't even show up.
Because he'll probably be there. So.
I really want to do Highlander, because both the Highlanders are going to be there.
I was shocked that Lee didn't get Highlander.
I haven't had anything since Baby Boba.
which was apparently entirely your fault.
Yeah,
I guess.
My kiss of death. Geez. So, no. Anyway.
You've
got Vern, you've got Princess Bride, you've got Weird Al, Jay's got Stan Lee, and I've got my hand in a bottle of lube.
I do feel bad because after the next episode, Jay will be incarcerated for murdering Stan Lee for challenging him to a push-up.
I wondered how long it was going to take before we made a joke about that. 7 minutes and 45
seconds.
Who had
that in the office pool?
I'm just looking.
I'm shocked if he's actually going to come as we record this.
Because he's been canceling from hell.
He canceled today to New York.
But so. I do believe that if Stan does make it and if Jay does challenge him, that Jay's actually going to lose that push-up contest. It may kill Stan, but he's going to do more push-ups than
Jay. That's good news and bad news for me because Jay's my friend, so good news. It's all good news because I have Stan Lee on my Deadpool.
Yes, you do.
Oh, you do.
So
you do.
That's a win-win.
Yes, all right.
Oh, and anyway, we're still introducing me. Come to my goddamn pub quiz, 8:30. Well, get there earlier, though. Get there at 8, Lucky 13.
Mm-hmm.
It's warming up. We're going to be out on the patio soon.
Very soon. He's sitting there with his hand in a bottle of lube.
Yeah.
He's Lee George K.
Trying to keep it moisturized.
You say hand in a bottle?
I thought that's what he said.
You did say that.
My hand and a bottle.
Okay.
All right. But as my Southern California accent tripped you guys up.
I guess.
Confused you. It's okay. Well, mostly I've been thinking about lube ever since that Deadpool trailer. Trailer.
That was pretty funny.
Yeah. So you see that butt and you just go, whoa. that butt, though.
Happy International Women's Day.
Exactly. So,
go ahead. Sorry.
Please, by all means.
I interrupted. I got several Happy International Women's Day from ladies, and I was like, I don't know how to take that after Deadpool.
I believe the word you take it like a man.
Yes, exactly.
I saw a lot of posts that were should you celebrate women every day? And I was like, yeah, obviously, but we can, just
I do my best.
Make a special day.
I celebrate me every day, but I still like a birthday card.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, there you go. Lee, high five. Yeah. That's great. That was great.
It sure was. So come check out my restaurant, Fresh Eatery, 145 East, 1300 South. That's Suite 201. We're open Monday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 8 p.m., and things have been really hopping, and it's been great.
Oh, good.
It's nice seeing people. It's especially fun when people from one of my other four businesses stop in to check on things, and they see that part of my empire chugging along. And if you want to check out the other four aspects of my empire, lgk.com is where I'm updating all that, because I've gone all in on the internalized crazy.
Oh, good.
I am going to just go ahead and operate every single business idea that pops into my head instantly. I'm just going to activate them, and I'm going to run them, and we'll see what happens.
Well, I'm going to need a job, so it's
good. Yeah, as long as you can stir kale and paint miniatures, I think you'll be all right.
Oh, well, I told you. I've been dealing with a lot of kale. You got to massage that shit.
You do have to massage that kale because it's one of the most cruciferous vegetables, and if you don't break down the cell walls, it leads to a lot of agitated stomachs.
It does.
Yeah.
That was a lot of big words.
I will remember that.
Yeah, you got to massage your kale. Now, you can do it two ways.
Massage your kale!
You can do it two ways. You can do it mechanically by chiffonading it really finely. So what that does is break down the cell walls on a cellular level with the, you know, the friction from the knife blade. The other way to do it
is mush it with my hands.
Yeah, a little bit of vinegar, a little bit of vinegar, and leave that for about 12 hours.
12?
Job too. 12?
Yeah, yeah.
Lord. I just massage it with my hands until it feels a little mushy.
That'll do the job too. Right. Or you can,
which
put
is the opposite of what I do when I go to bed at night.
dredge it in a little bit of olive oil and put it in your broiler on 450 for about 15 minutes, and you have a delicious snack.
Are we talking about happy endings?
Yeah.
No, Shannon's talking about how he goes to bed with kale every night.
Yeah.
I thought kale was the name of an Asian woman. That
he's
that's
talking.
Weird, that's a weird noise you hear next door. Every day.
He's talking about happy endings. He's Jimmy Martin.
Hello.
Listen
the
to me.
Tip
I'm
is on the table. Hi. Watch me on KSL, which apparently today, as we record this, I didn't know I was on until I got a text message that said, "Hey, you can be here in like 90 minutes." It's like, oh shit! Like I still had like a 4-day grown beard, and I'm like, oh fuck,
4 days.
I don't know how you do that.
I go, no one told me. But sure, yeah, I'll be there. Scrape, makeup.
Between that and missing your taxes, you need to have a schedule. Yeah. Son.
No,
schedule,
I didn't miss. Right? My I mean, you taxes. Got a very, I just had a tax meeting.
All right,
yeah, you got a very busy schedule.
Yes. All right, I actually fly out tomorrow. Tune in next week's episode. I'll have interviews with the cast of Power Rangers.
Ooh.
Pacific Rim 2.
Woohoo! I hope it's good.
It's going to be great.
I hope every movie's good. I don't want to watch it.
Because you have to watch it.
Shit.
I hope it's good, too, or else I'm going to really hate the guy who made the trailer for it, because he makes me want to see it.
Yep.
Oh.
Based on the trailer, yeah. I think it looks
kind of
cool.
Why would you hate him? He's good at his job.
I'm glad. That's why
the director and writer's bad at their fucking job. Be mad at them.
Hey,
Jesus Christ, Tony.
Don't make me be logical.
No, don't you fucking start with me.
Ah!
It's Friday night.
I'm glad that finally the Asian character isn't the Yellow Ranger.
And the Black Ranger is not the black guy.
Exactly. Hey.
He's the Blue Ranger.
Lessons learned from the 90s.
It actually kind of pisses me off.
Well, two steps forward, one step back. Yeah. There it is.
There is the Orange Ranger, though, and he's an asshole.
Yeah.
He's the president. Maybe.
He's huge.
And the White Ranger is his lead advisor.
So, listen to me on Arrow, Mediocre Show.
Oh, God, it's
show.
The White Power Ranger.
It is. He is the White Power Ranger.
Fire's my sword!
Huh. I wouldn't have got that joke when I was watching Power Rangers younger, but I get it now. Well,
those were better times.
Oh, boy.
So,
Is the Green Power Ranger, is he vegan?
They don't pay attention to that.
Get your stuff there, Jimmy.
Do what?
Tell us about your stuff.
Oh, I thought I did.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
He did.
Yeah.
All right.
Cool. We're throwing off because it's Friday night.
Oh, that's it.
Yeah.
And we have a host.
No.
Wait, no, we haven't got to do this.
We have a Tony.
Oh, we didn't get to Tony yet?
No.
Yeah, hey, you may have a host.
I thought you went first.
No. You may have a host. We have a Tony.
No.
Get in his belly.
Carrie, we're fucked.
He's Quadski.
Hey, excited to be here on Friday night. Check me out on Twitter at QuadTTony or on the Gadget Spot.
G-Spot.
Yeah, it's a podcast I do with Excitable James, my cousin Jaron, and my friend Owen. It's all about gadgets, tech, and video games. That's all I do.
And we do have a host. He actually wrote Henry Mancini's Baby Elephant Walk, Mr. Kerry Jackson.
Woo! I did.
It's a
little
known fact.
What is that?
He traveled back in time and wrote it.
Yeah. Just next time you're bored.
Okay.
YouTube. Baby Elephant Walk.
Yeah. It's been shown. That story's been shown on like 4 different time travel shows, but they always make it about something different.
Like
stopping the Hindenburg.
My inspiration was watching my grandmother.
Because she looked like a baby elephant?
She kind of.
That's because she wrapped her nose around whoever's walking in front of her.
Right. Okay. Yes. Monday through Friday, 6 to 10, x96.com.
So I listen every morning now, right? Mm-hmm. It makes me so I'm not late for work. I completely fucking adore the disdain you have for the feature the question of best question of the week.
Hate that.
You're
feature.
Fucking it. You and it's just and you don't fucking oh. hide it.
What?
And it's beautiful and amazing.
What time is that on so I can tune in?
It's
Fridays at 7.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. He fucking he's not having it.
I'm gonna have to get out of bed earlier.
he picks shitty music for it.
Mm-hmm.
He's just like, fuck this whole feature. And I'm just like, God damn it, that's why I love him. That's why he's my captain.
You're Betsy DeVosing it.
Yes. Oh. Two reasons I don't like the feature. One, I don't believe they are the best questions.
Mm. Sure.
I find your questions inferior.
Mm.
So you bring it. Second reason I hate it, yeah. it was Richie's idea. So anyway.
Well, and also, honestly, I think the third reason, the real reason, is you don't think it's anybody's fucking business.
Can I say one thing before we move forward?
Yes.
Last night I had a revelation. I thought Johnny Rotten was dead.
No.
I don't know why. I thought he was.
No, dude. Sid Vicious.
He was on Conan.
Sid Vicious is dead.
Sid Vicious is for sure. I see, you hear in the background, the Sex Pistols are playing.
Top five bucket list of people I want to interview so I can feel stupid afterwards. John Lydon's one of the smartest motherfuckers on this planet.
Two times lucky enough to have interviewed him. And he is a smart motherfucker. And you expect he's going to be a problem, but he's not.
No, if he doesn't think you're an idiot, he's a really good interviewer.
Yeah.
But if he thinks you're an idiot, then he's going to...
Then he fucks with you.
Yeah. But, I have never, ever felt as inferior of an intellect as I have listening to John Lydon.
Well, he'd probably treat me like a piece of shit. I'd be like, I thought you were dead.
You should read his biography.
I will.
I've got it around here somewhere. It's No Jews, No Blacks, No Irish.
Ah.
Or no, it's No Dogs, No Blacks, No Irish. Yeah. That's the name.
PIL, man. I love PIL, too.
Yeah.
Anyway. Sorry.
Anyway, so here's the thing you need to know about FanX Weekend.
Okay.
And how you can live the magic that is this podcast. Friday at 3 p.m. in room 150G. Is that a good size room?
I think it's 400.
Yeah.
Give or take.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I packed that.
Let's fill that fucker.
I packed it with my one-man show last
week. Did you know? Yeah. Okay. Friday, 3 p.m., room 150G in the Salt Palace Convention Center. We'll be recording and doing a panel.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
And then the best part, the next night, our own party, doors at 7, show is at 8, promptly.
Promptly.
At 8.
Promptly.
We,
Shannon can figure out the way to get there.
Shut the fuck up.
We are going to show, because they have a big, they have like a theater kind of a setup in there.
Big screen.
This is a dream.
Yeah, this is fun, because when Jay said, I've never seen Raiders of the Lost Ark, I got so many notices, people saying, when that happens, mm-hmm. I want to be there.
I put out a Twitter poll about 3 weeks ago, and mm-hmm. that's the single largest reaction I've had mm-hmm. to anything on Twitter, even more than my nudes.
So this is your chance. This is your chance to watch Raiders of the Lost Ark for the first time with Jay.
With an excitable gentleman.
And with us. We're going to set up couches down in front of the screen for us, and we will all have microphones. So we'll all be watching the movie on that big screen. Everybody in the place will be. It's free. And we'll be recording a podcast at the same time. We'll be riffing on the movie.
What could go wrong?
I don't know.
So many things.
So many things.
There's a long list.
I mean, seriously, I'm going to have to use all the self-control I have in my fucking body
to
be able to even make it there.
This could be great. It could fail miserably.
It's going to be great.
But either way, you're going to be able to see Indiana Jones, Raiders of the Lost Ark, with Jay and Geek Show and all of us.
Well,
and then right afterward, after that's done, a DJ is coming in, and you're welcome to stay again for free. And there's going to be a dance party. You know,
I'm going to request
it becomes a club.
Joe over and over and over again.
Do it.
You can only dance so many times to that.
The problem is the DJ only has one track. It's...
and baby elephant dance.
I'm requesting Yakety Sack.
It's the club at 50 West, 50 West Broadway in Salt Lake City. It's a block away from the Salt Palace.
You can stumble there easily.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You can stumble right over there.
And we have experience. We know exactly how many...
I know how to get there now.
There's
how many stumbles to get there? Seven? Mm-hmm. Eight?
And there's a bar there. And,
yep.
Hamburger?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
nacho platter?
It's going to be great. So that's the 18th.
Twice fried potato.
Oh, you're getting...
And Excitable James will have merchandise there.
Yeah.
Oh.
Limited edition stuff.
Yeah. A shirt you can only get
A shirt there. You can only get there. It's what he's saying, anyway, yep. Unless he doesn't sell them.
Seriously.
All of them.
This will be your last.
I'm going to log right on to Middle Aged Boaters and pick
asterisk,
that shit up.
Asterisk next to it.
This will be your last chance.
Unless we don't sell these all.
This will be your last chance to get the shirt before it shows up at the Savers in Midvale in 6 months.
That's right. All right. Speaking of Power Rangers.
Woo! Oh, white God, Power Rangers!
You salute way too
Black
hard
Power
when you do
Ranger.
That.
I stopped mid-fist. I realized where that was going.
Uh-oh.
And I apologize.
Do you have 17 entire days worth of free time on your hands?
Peck? Sure.
No.
Oh,
no.
I know where this is going. I read about
that.
Yes.
Job.
Twitch is live streaming every episode of the Power Rangers TV show.
No.
Now, just the original or like all like Dino all Rangers?
It's, oh, it fits 17 days. It's all
yeah.
of them.
Yeah, yeah. It says all 23 complete seasons
oh,
from
God.
All the way from Mighty Morphin to Dino Supercharge, 831 episodes.
Yeah. Oh,
and
Jesus.
The stream will start on March 14th at 11 in the morning.
Well, I know where Eddie's going to be.
And end sometime on March 30th.
I'd rather.
I know where he's going to be in 17 days.
I'd rather burn my dick off than do that.
So, there's your, you know, to get you ready for the movie, I guess.
Burn it right off.
I'm excited but nervous
about the Power Rangers movie.
Can I honestly tell you, I don't give two fucks about this movie, but I can't wait to see it.
I am cautiously optimistic.
I don't give a fuck. It was a show that my kid watched.
I don't have a horse in the race.
Yeah.
So I watched
fair amount of Power Rangers when I was younger.
I was just talking with a friend down at KSL, and he's about 5 years younger than I am, and he was like, oh, I totally watched Power Rangers. I was just on the cusp of like, mm-hmm. I'm too old for this.
Mm-hmm.
So I watched it, but didn't like love it.
I watched it religiously because the industry I worked in when it started, I was a behavior manager for children with autism. And that show, for some reason, it seemed like it was a magic spell because these kids who were normally throwing us through walls and trying to murder us all the time would actually sit down and watch Power Rangers. So we're like, record every episode.
Huh.
I remember the first season, I watched a couple.
Yeah.
And I just couldn't. I couldn't do it.
I found it hilarious.
It was really bad.
It was funny.
Yeah.
But in a bad, funny way. Yeah. I think it was Rita Repulsa that made me go,
this is like an Asian thing.
That they're shooting American actors into.
Yeah, right. Yeah. It was like what they did with Battle of the Planets.
And then I became aware of that, and I started looking for that, where the seams were. And,
to me, I think for the movie to be successful is do your action, have some good effects, but maybe realize it's kind of a goofy franchise.
Yeah, yeah. It can't take itself too seriously.
You know what I mean? Like,
Who's playing Rita Repulsa? Is it Kristen Bell?
No, it's Elizabeth Banks.
Unless she talks like this.
She doesn't.
I'm not going to go.
She doesn't. Well, I know how the movie's going to end. I mean, the big thing for anybody who watched that first season was when Tommy turned out to be the evil Green Ranger, and that's probably how the movie's going to end.
I never got over that betrayal.
That betrayal was terrible.
And then when
he took all their power coins, and then he came back as the White Ranger and redeemed himself.
He came back as the White Power Ranger.
Yeah, yeah. And it was like Bannon.
No, the one thing that I have some hope is one Elizabeth Banks because she's a good actress
and she's doing it for fun.
Yeah, well, the person who I think is doing it either for fun or maybe he saw something worthwhile is Bryan Cranston.
No, he's paying. That was one of his first gigs.
I know. I know that he used to do like additional voices back in the day. That was one of his first gigs.
Like,
so either he's doing this just for I can do whatever I want. Yeah. You know.
I'm fucking Bryan Cranston.
Or this is kind of cool, and I'm going to do it because. Yeah. So, it's one of those ones I'm really kind of nervous about, but we'll see.
Can I go see it?
Huh?
I want to go see it.
Well, I'm flying away.
Seeing it.
Take me
in a faraway land.
So no,
he's seeing. I think he's.
There's not going to be a preview here.
There might be.
I think he's going to L.A.
You fucking asshole.
I know. Let's see. Got some casting news.
Excellent.
People have jobs.
For what?
Jobs for people.
For who?
People that have more money than us.
We got the captain of the USS Discovery.
I saw this one.
I seen this.
Oh man.
And it's he was on a Harry Potter as well, wasn't
he's Draco's dad.
Draco's dad. Okay.
Yep.
He was Bob Draco.
Lucius Malfoy.
Jason Isaacs.
Jason Isaac, the voice of the Grand Galactic Inquisitor on Star Wars Rebels.
That's true. He does. I looked him up. He does a lot of voice work.
Yeah, he did a show on NBC a couple of years back where he was an L.A. police detective who was split between two realities, one where his wife was murdered and another one where his son was murdered.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I actually interviewed this guy at Sundance.
He's
I watched that show, too.
It was a good show.
Really good. Yeah.
It was a good show. I can't remember what it was called. But,
mostly because he was great.
But yeah. now it was pointed out that, you know, keep in mind, he's not the star of the show.
No.
He's just a captain.
They've been filming for a bit now.
Yeah.
He's just the captain of the Discovery, because the whole take on this series is not the captain is the star of the show. It's the first officer.
It's number one.
Yeah. And that's Shaniqua Martin Green from Walking Dead.
Nice.
Sasha.
And that's cool, though. Like,
I like that.
And it's Brian Fuller, man. Like, why wouldn't
it's
he
not
do that?
Brian Fuller. It's not Brian Fuller anymore.
No, he's out.
Oh, yep. Fuck but, that but shit.
It is the two people that did Pushing Daisies with him.
Yeah.
Pushing Daisies.
Get over there, Davey.
Get out of the road, Dick.
Yep. Stop pushing me.
I'm Davey, and I'm tired of being pushed around.
I'm tired of being pushed.
I don't know.
Don't push Davey. Nobody puts Davey in a corner.
Davey got two good legs.
And we also got our Domino cast.
Yep.
This week.
Tova Borgnine. Who would have thought?
I know, right?
Not.
Is she still around?
No. Probably. Yeah. I don't know.
Who cares?
I'm happy for Ron Perlman. I think he's going to be great.
put her on my desk.
As Tova Borgnine?
The sexiest Domino ever.
That's right.
Mr. Ron Perlman. That's
right. It is, let's see, Zazie Beetz.
Who?
What?
Zazie Beetz. Beetz.
That's not
I don't know. That sounds like a breakfast cereal.
No,
that sounds like a hip hop name.
Beetz. She is from. She plays Van on Atlanta, Donald Glover show.
Oh,
the best part of waking up is Zazie Beetz in your cup.
but she is. She's playing Domino.
That's nice. Cool.
Yeah.
And Nathan Summers is coming. Said that phone booth.
I don't mean to sound racist. Is she African American?
She is.
Yeah.
And Domino's usually
super white,
right?
Domino's as white as you can get.
She's
except
colors.
For right around
I,
her eye.
I point you to my X-Men expert.
Yeah, her skin is like preternaturally white.
Yeah,
and she has that.
It's like paper white.
That's cool.
Bingo around
and
her
it's
eye.
Black, I'm, black, oh, but you know what? It's black, not brown black.
She I said my entire career, I don't give a shit if it matches the comic or origin source.
Yeah.
If you're a good actress, actor, whatever, go for it.
I agree.
And
I remember, what's her name play Domino?
Nobody's played Domino.
Keira Knightley.
That was the movie called Domino, but
that
was
different.
Yeah, it's very much.
I never saw it.
Thank you. Thank you for allowing us to clarify that movie related question for you, Jimmy.
Okay. I don't know every goddamn movie.
Can I ask you a question about Long Division?
Slapping you around, Jimmy.
I don't give a fuck.
No, I like to pretend that Domino with Keira Knightley was about her, but then it makes me sad because it was not a good movie.
I never saw it.
Let's talk about Logan real quick because I've got some of the...
I miss him. I miss him. I liked living with him.
That's a different Logan.
Okay. Hold on.
He smelled good.
He used too much hot sauce on his food.
We got to remain spoiler free still.
Yeah.
For a couple more weeks.
Yeah, definitely.
Yep.
Definitely.
Because I've got the map going after happens after Logan here from Simon Kinberg.
Okay. Spoiler alert, Hugh Jackman's still alive.
Yep.
Hugh Jackman?
So is Patrick Stewart. He's adopting rescue pit bulls. And they're the most adorable videos on the internet.
And he wants to take on Trump.
Patrick Stewart did say that he would return as Charles Xavier if it was for Deadpool. For Deadpool.
Well, it's like the same thing Hugh Jackman said.
As long as
not for Deadpool.
As long as this is not
Avengers.
A spoiler, but Logan takes place in 2029.
Yeah.
So, yes, they could return at any time during that timeline. Mm-hmm. Plus, Hugh Jackman's really old and beat up in 2029, so he could still play Logan if he wanted to.
Sure.
Yeah.
Anyway, so, but you guys saw it.
Yeah.
I have not seen it.
Well,
I might.
Why don't you see a fucking movie every once in a while, Jackson?
Have you seen Batman yet?
What the fuck? You haven't seen Batman Lego either, huh? God damn it.
I'm
not mad at you. I'm so fucking disappointed.
The last movie you saw was Rogue One, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
You haven't been to a movie since December.
I've not been to a movie. I've seen movies since then. And then there's, My screen. I love my screen.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I hear you.
But you.
Jesus Christ.
I feel you.
You had a problem or two?
No.
Logan?
Yes and no.
Yes and no?
Yes and no.
Minor?
No.
Spit it out, you son of a bitch.
If you're not with Logan, you're against
it. One, my mom is a lovely person. Logan. Logan was brutal.
It was.
Yeah.
It's a brutal, brutal movie.
It's a fucking Wolverine movie. Finally.
No, it's not actually. That's the Wolverine you guys headcanoned. That Wolverine does not exist in the comics.
Oh, bullshit.
It may be in the Marvel Max universe, but for the most part, yeah. That's anyway. It is an extraordinarily violent movie, and I would say to people who are maybe sensitive towards violence, it may not be your movie. It might be a movie you want to stick away from. That being said, the performances are fantastic. Some of the subtext that's going on in there is there's a really, really, really subtle scene with bad hombres in the beginning,
mm-hmm.
and then migrants that are running for their lives at the end. So you end up seeing some very interesting social statements going on. But they're not overtly, they're not like, let's beat you over the head.
Yeah, not at all.
And I 100% agree with you. Yeah. I thought the same thing. It was like how Star Trek was, you know, or has been. It was kind of an allegory of stuff that is going on.
Yeah, because especially right that now. The bad hombre thing happening right by the border, and you're like, fuck, come on, guys, let's not play that. And then I realized what the long game was. So I can honestly say it was a beautifully shot movie, incredibly acted, wonderfully written. The action in it is top notch, and I might not ever watch it again.
But I didn't like it.
No, I liked it.
No, I love it. Like,
no, that's the hardest thing about it is I really liked it. I don't like the way it made me feel. I felt walking out of that movie.
I'm sorry. Like, Wolverine's main feature is he has
big claws,
giant fucking super sharp metal fucking claws.
And what the fuck's
he gonna do with those? He's gonna
problem.
Cut off your arms. He's gonna cut off your legs. He's gonna stab you in the heart. He's gonna stab you up through your fucking head. That's what his fucking powers are.
To me,
for a Superman fan to say that, I find entertaining.
Well, no, but so he's not.
He's not. But
he's
that's
not
that's,
Superman.
That's what makes Wolverine Wolverine. That's what makes Logan's struggle real. Is that he can do that shit, and he does do that shit, and sometimes he goes out of control. Wolverine is a character that is perfect for a teenage kid to read because you are out of control. Your hormones are raging. The world doesn't make any
fucking
sense.
And if you had metal claws, you'd fucking cut off your bully's arm. You'd fucking stab him through his fucking head.
Perhaps you would. But ultimately, and again, don't get me wrong. I think people keep hearing me say I didn't like the movie. I really liked the movie. I really appreciated the movie.
Lee George Kane hated this movie.
No. I just seriously, and the farther I get away from it, the more I can appreciate it. It's one of those things that you think about a lot, and there's some stuff that sticks in
your
head.
For me, the violence-wise, it always reminds me of, I'd say, like Ninja Turtles in the sense that, like, you always see, like, Leonardo. No, you see Leonardo never uses swords, never uses, you know, like that. Whereas
it's
Wolverine.
Stupid.
Yeah. Whereas Wolverine, you always see him like, oh, I'm going to scratch a robot or I'm going to do this.
I'm going to hit you with the blood side of my fucking claws.
I think James Mangold and Hugh Jackman were like, let's show what this fucker can do. Like, this is what he is built. He is a fucking aggressive son of a bitch.
Sure. And he's
a killing machine.
He's at the point in his life now where he's been beaten down so far that he just
doesn't give a fuck anymore.
Well, exactly.
They touch on the human issue on it.
The little girl? Because he's like, don't fucking do what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God. And X-23. Holy shit.
Yeah, she scares me.
Well, she's supposed to.
More scary than fucking Wolverine.
Yeah,
I think,
for sure.
She's like all feral and shit. And I was like, oh, God, I'm glad the kids at the set don't have claws.
That little actress, she is something else.
I really don't want to spoil anything, and I'm trying to think how to phrase it to not. But after everything they've gone through, X-23 and Logan together, there's that scene where they're in the shack together towards the end.
Yeah.
And he's like, I don't know what you think I am, but it's not me.
Yeah.
And like, I'm a fucking ruthless killer. And
it's,
you know, you can look up to me like a dad if you want, but
don't be me.
Duh.
Yeah. It's
be a better gun.
I think it's a beautiful fucking film.
It is absolutely amazing.
What I'm talking about is after they've gone through a lot of shit together.
It's amazing.
See, I think where
Carrie Jackson should go see that.
Batman.
Where I hesitate on any of these stories is that when it's done properly. In my mind, again, this is me. It's completely me. It's more of an Iron Giant story. Are you a gun?
Okay, that's what you. That's okay.
Yeah,
yeah.
And that's where Wolverine always resonated with me. And I can tell you, as somebody who got the shit kicked out of him all the way through junior high school, who read Wolverine comics like they were crack, if I'd had those claws, it wouldn't have been, I'm going to cut my bully's arm off. It's going to be, am I a gun?
Let me ask you this though. Because I was talking about somebody about this the other day.
Mm-hmm.
I think the villains in Logan are the most ruthless and unstoppable villains.
The Reavers?
That they have, that anybody in the X-Men has ever faced.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
What
yeah.
other choice did he have
he didn't
than
have...
to just fucking hack him up?
You take him out or you risk them or coming back
you,
the next day.
Right? Yeah. Or they're going to kill
no,
you.
Yep.
They're going to kill Professor X.
I'm not disagreeing.
They're
going
to kill X-23. They're going to kill
I'm not
the fucking kindly fucking... farm people,
I'm
children.
I'm not. Well, and that's the other warning I will give people. Now it's funny because these movies come out, and a lot of people get upset with people who bring their kids to see them. I'm going to put this out there: if somebody gave me shit about bringing my teenage kid to see this movie, I would probably get right in their face about it because I'd rather my kid see that movie with me, where we can have a conversation about it afterwards, mm-hmm. than have them download it and watch it without me knowing.
Ah, okay.
Or go over to a friend's house and watch it on HBO in 6 months and have some serious fucking problems. For instance, like when I stayed up all night and watched American Werewolf in London when I was 11, I really wish I had had my dad with me to talk to me about some shit because that movie fucked with my brain.
Gotta fucking love that movie.
It's a great movie.
All right, so here's what's happening. Here's what...
Man, we should do more Friday night shows. We're feisty.
Here's what Simon Kinberg says.
That's right.
About where it's going.
We were going somewhere with this.
He says, after the Logan stuff, here's the overview. We're working hard on New Mutants, Gambit with Channing Tatum. Yeah, I'll believe that.
Never happened.
That'll never happen.
Deadpool 2 and the new X-Force movie where Deadpool is alongside Cable and other characters.
Nice.
He says...
Phantom X.
X-Force is a combination of Deadpool and Cable. They're like the Black Ops of the X-Men, much darker, have an R-rated decibel.
Yep.
There are other X-Men characters coming to X-Force at different times of the comic, but it is separate from X-Men, because they are working on an X-Men movie right now.
Hmm. They're at a very interesting time, and again, I'm not saying I didn't like Logan. I really did actually appreciate the hell out of that movie, but I was sobbing halfway through that movie. Like, I could not emotionally deal with a couple of things that happened. Now, I do have a hard time with violence towards kids in movies. And there's a bit of that. And so...
Yeah, but they're fake kids. They're not real.
Yeah, they're just mutant kids in Mexico City. It doesn't count. But it's...
No, it's fucked up. It's fucked up, yeah. And it's relevant. And that's why
super,
I loved it.
Super, super relevant.
It was super relevant. It was a super relevant allegory to what is going on in today's society, and I appreciate it for that.
And that's one of the reasons I liked it so much is because it made me feel.
Well, and you do see this is what's interesting.
Doesn't happen very often with me.
It takes place 12 years from now, right? It takes place 12 years from now.
Yeah.
And you actually very clearly see societal decline. It's not post-apocalyptic.
Right.
It's actually what is going to happen if society keeps going the direction it's going.
For sure.
Rights will disappear.
Yeah.
Things will gradually decline to a point where it's complete and total anarchy, and you can see it. But on the other hand, people seem to be grossly unaware of it.
I described the setting...
Like, one day we'll be guerrilla radio.
Yeah, I described the setting of that movie to one of my friends as the closest you can be to a post-apocalyptic movie without actually being a post-apocalyptic movie.
The gradual...
It's like right on the cusp.
It's right on the cusp.
It's teetering off the edge.
Yeah. And the only thing society.
That makes me think of a movie like that, I don't know why, for some reason for me, is Alien Nation.
The first, I
agree with you.
The movie that I see that with is the first Mad Max, because in the very first Mad Max...
That's a little bit more over the edge.
That was further over the edge.
I'm talking the very first
Mad Max, not Road Warrior.
He's still a cop. He still reports to the police precinct. True. There's still cities. There's still diners. There's still people hanging out in villages.
Yeah.
There's still communities. But if you go out on the fucking highway, you're dead.
I couldn't understand a word in that movie.
Turn on the closed caption.
I got to watch the closed caption with that one.
Kabi Kabi.
After these messages, we'll be right back.
Talking about sex can be uncomfortable, and you know it shouldn't have to be. At Black Velvet Boutique, they believe there's no shame in sex or wanting to be educated about sex. Black Velvet Boutique is an all-inclusive, judgment-free shopping environment. They emphasize positive relationships between partners and with oneself. Black Velvet Boutique, they're located on 293 South State Street in Clearfield, Utah. You can go to blackvelvetboutique.com or give them a call, 801-525-1583. They're open 7 days a week. They are locally owned and operated, staffed by some really cool, fun, compassionate, and caring women, Dawn and Leah. Very supportive, very passionate about making sure that their customers have a positive experience. You're free to shop anonymously, or engage with any of the Black Velvet Boutique staff. They're interested in building honest dialogue and relationships with their customers and helping people make informed choices. Black Velvet Boutique is, it's not a porn store or a novelty store. It's for grown-ups who enjoy or want to enjoy sex. Black Velvet Boutique, huge advocates of self-care, which is about understanding your body and sexual needs and desires. Visit them at their store, 293 South State Street in Clearfield, or call them. Ask them about their free workshops. Black Velvet Boutique. Salt Lake Comic Con presents FanX 2017, March 17th and 18th at the Salt Palace Convention Center. Get your tickets at saltlakecomiccon.com. There are many Comic Cons around the world and the country, but there is only one, FanX. Backed by popular demand, Salt Lake Comic Con is excited to announce FanX 2017 on March 17th and 18th at the Salt Palace Convention Center. The main goal of FanX 2017 is to produce an intimate, fun, family-oriented, unique, and even more affordable fan experience for you attendees. Shop hundreds of talented art and merchandise vendors. Meet celebrity guests like the legendary Stan Lee, Bonnie Wright, Weird Al Yankovic, Jason Momoa, and more. Meet the stars from your favorite fandoms like Highlander, the cast from Harry Potter, The Walking Dead, Princess Bride, Lord of the Rings, Star Wars, Psych, and more. Heck, you can see Geek Show live on Friday. Get the full lineup and purchase tickets at saltlakecomiccon.com. Salt Lake Comic Con is presented by Wasatch Front Subaru Retailers and Subaru of America, Inc. Cabin Fever has been providing customers with hand-picked greeting cards, gift wrap, books, and gifts since it opened its doors in 1982. Located at the heart of Trolley Square on the corner of 500 South and 700 East, Cabin Fever has been helping the meek, the geek, and the freak since day one. Stop by and see what's in stores. They're currently getting their spring merchandise. Cabin Fever prides itself on hand-picking every item for the store, from books and greeting cards to action figures, all of it, even the wrapping paper and bows. Stop by, say hi, tell them Geek Show says hey. They love Geek Show customers. Since 1982, Cabin Fever, from action figures, playing cards, jigsaw puzzles, gift books, magic, and more, Cabin Fever carries a large selection of awesome, giveable, and receivable merchandise. Located in the heart of Trolley Square at the corner of 500 South and 700 East, it's Cabin Fever. So much more than a card store. It's Cabin Fever. Smells great, tastes even better. Full service catering and home delivery service from Geek Show friend of the program, Chef Daniel Cantu. Home delivery service geared for those who can't cook, won't cook, or are too busy. Or maybe you've decided to make a change in your diet and don't know where to start. This is from scratch cooking. Daniel's menus change weekly. You can order as much or as little as you'd like. There's a $40 minimum. No commitment to order every week. Chef Daniel, yes, I knew you were going to ask, can accommodate all food preferences and allergies. Vegan, vegetarian, paleo, gluten, dairy-free. Chef Daniel sources a lot of his ingredients locally when possible because we got farmers markets, ranchers, dairies, and bakeries all over. He can also do catering like he's done for us. Catering is available for all sorts of special events, weddings, business lunches, parties, anniversaries, third shows, what have you. Go to his website, cantuscatering.com. That's C-A-N-T-U-S catering.com for more information. You can submit a home delivery request or contact Chef Daniel directly, 801-359-6035. He's done a great job for us in the past, and you will get a special discount if you tell Daniel, Geek Show says hey. Dr. Volt's Comic Connection for the month of March. Let's see what's going on. Salt Lake Fan X is back, and Dr. Volts will see you there at booth 831. We're going to have toys, pop figures, comics, and maybe even a surprise or two. But if you don't feel down, if you can't make it to Fan X, Dr. Volts is here for you, of course. March 24th through the 26th, Dr. Volts will be having their March Madness sale. It means you get 20 to 50% off of graphic novels and back issues. Hey, did you like Logan? Maybe you should check out the continuing adventures of X-23 and Logan in All New Wolverine and Old Man Logan. Celebrated Goosebumps author R.L. Stine is bringing his trademark brand of horror this month to Marvel's Man-Thing. Adventure into fear as Man-Thing must confront his evil doppelganger. Support local businesses. Get out of the house. Make some new friends in real life. 2043 East, 3300 South in Salt Lake City. They're open 7 days a week. Their hold service is free. And with that, you get a discount of 20% off your purchases over $20 or more. And you get the previews catalog for free. 2043 East, 3300 South. Dr. Volt's Comic Connection.
Hey everybody, this is Jimmy Martin for the Geek Show Podcast, and my wife, Kat Martin, has a special offer just for you.
Are you tired of dusting your Legos?
Yep.
Polishing your Funko Pops?
Oh, yeah.
And just cleaning your house in general?
Yep.
Well, give Kat's Cleaning a call at 801-403-7342 today. With 17 years experience, Kat, that's me, has carefully selected my employees and trained them in all of my ridiculously OCD ways. Check out Kat's Cleaning SLC on Yelp and Facebook, Kat is with a K, to read our 5-star reviews and visit katscleaningslc.com for more info. We've even been featured on local news and actually cleaned for local celebrities, including the one and only Carrie Jackson.
Oh, thank you. Mention Geek Show for a 10% discount. That's 801-403-7342. Or go to katscleaningslc.com.
Kat with a K.
Oh, yeah. And we're back.
Are we ever.
Boy, that was probably our best break ever.
I think so.
Yeah. We learned and we grew.
So all y'all sitting and listening to this podcast right now in your cubicles at work, I've got two assignments for you.
Oh, what?
First assignment.
Overthrow the man.
All right. Second assignment.
Then overthrow the other man.
Third assignment.
There's too many assignments.
You got to let me.
Oh, sorry. Your assignment.
All the podcasts that I listen to are doing this thing where during the month of March, they want you to be podcast missionaries, for lack of a better term.
Mm. Okay.
So I would love it if y'all listening to in the cubicle right now would tell people about this show. Spread the word about this show.
Just not to your boss.
Just not to your boss.
Unless your boss is cool.
Or yeah. My boss.
If you love the show, turn it on to some people who you think would also love it. All right?
Yeah, like-minded deviants.
Three people.
Exactly. Or two. Even if everybody just did two. That'd be fine.
Terry Hairdresser.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, I think you guys would like these idiots.
Look, if one of you guys can reach Kevin Bacon, we'll all
exactly.
be good.
Yeah. And if you really, really, really like Donald Trump, make sure you listen to our show.
Absolutely.
We're fans, too.
Then the other thing is that you're sitting there at your cubicle. You got the computer in front of you. I've got some stuff for you to watch.
Uh-oh. What's that, Kerry?
Well, besides our YouTube channel.
Which is just great. You can watch us.
If you think we sound dynamic, imagine how we look.
Exactly.
Oh, my God. We've got a face made for podcasting.
Yeah. It's Geek Show, one word. There's that, but there's three things that you need to look at right now.
Overthrowing the man.
Well, no.
Short hair Thor.
You need to calm your fucking tits.
First of all, there's a new Wonder Woman trailer.
Is there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I haven't watched it yet.
When does it come out again?
Tomorrow. Monday, Sunday.
Now
it's out now.
The movie
at the time that you hear this
trailer.
Episode, the trailer.
Oh, I thought you meant the movie. I was like, no way. No,
I think I'm at the point I don't want to watch anymore.
So watch that. Oh yeah, you don't.
I think I might be done.
I'm excited for it. So
they already sold me. I'm going to see.
I feel the same way. Like once I realized Ray had a new hairstyle, I don't want to watch any episode 8.
Ruined
trailers.
The movie. Yeah. Then the other thing that you need to look for, it's really kind of cool. I want you just to go to YouTube and search Alien Covenant. Meet Walter.
Oh, I watched this today.
Did you watch this?
Yeah.
I saw you shared that on Facebook.
Yeah.
Too.
Meet Walter.
Ah, fucking Michael Fassbender.
It's a fake commercial.
Weyland-Yutani Company.
Yeah. For the David from the David 8 line. Series of androids, given the name that Weyland, named them. But he is number 8. And the video is creepy as hell.
In a way, only a replicant can be.
Yeah, building, and it's kind of Westworld-y in a way.
I love that Ridley Scott actually in Prometheus. There's a couple of screens that tie the Weyland-Yutani Corporation to
the Tyrell Corporation.
Yep. And mm-hmm. both being Ridley Scott movies, that's kind of a brilliant move because here you have your Blade Runner replicants.
What? I didn't notice this.
Yes, the Weyland-Yutani computers on their consoles on the bridge of the ship.
Yeah.
In Prometheus is talking about some of the Series 6, the Nexus 6 replicants from Tyrell Corporation.
Crazy.
I love that you brought that up actually because for many of the reasons I love my wife, but we went to Kong Skull Island. We'll talk about that later.
Yes.
But one of the teasers they played before the show was Blade Runner 2049, mm-hmm. what it is with Ryan Gosling.
Yeah.
And we were driving home. She's like, what is Blade Runner?
And I go, oh my.
What?
Oh, see, my wife hasn't seen it yet.
My wife sleeps through it every time I try to show it to her.
Can I tell you guys?
Yeah, I showed it to my wife. She watched it.
I'm not a fan.
What?
Oh, you're really? I'm not a fan.
What? What in the name of Logan are you talking about?
Now, here's the thing. I will say, it is not your typical sci-fi action movie.
It's very cerebral.
It's a detective story.
It's a slow burn.
It's a very slow burn.
It's one chapter of the
book. I wrote a 10-page research report about all the aspects of what Blade Runner is.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. I love that movie.
Yeah.
And I go, she's like, let's watch it. So Kat and our buddy Riyadh and I watched it 3 days ago.
Yeah, I was supposed to come over. I was tired.
And
I was tired.
They were like, this is really slow. And I'm like, you just got to appreciate it. You got to look at like the cinematography. You got to look at everything that's in it.
No, it's a beautifully filmed movie, for sure.
I fucking love it.
Except for the time that it was made.
And the copy I have is so like scrubbed and cleaned, like you would never guess it was made in 1982.
I have the six version.
Yeah, me too.
With every version of it, and it's interesting because there's the one version where he actually cut in the unicorn scene from Legend.
Yeah, that's in there.
That's Decker's dream. You know, because Decker's in the book, he's a replicant. And
spoilers,
such a great movie.
If you haven't read Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep by now, you're not going to.
Off, right? to summarize, I'm fucking excited for Blade Runner 2049.
So Alien.
Yes,
Alien.
At the end of this commercial for the robot, they send you to a website called meetwalter.com.
No.
Exactly, because I know how Lee feels about the robots.
If it happens correctly and we get a Ghost in the Shell future, I'll be okay. I just don't. I mean, I was already wrong about the Star Trek future that isn't happening. So,
at meetwalter.com, you can learn all about Walter's features.
No.
There are things like, Let him observe, analyze, and predict so you can avoid trouble before it starts.
I need that.
Let him mow your lawn.
I need one of those.
And him having no emotional needs, but he's been engineered to perceive a full spectrum of feelings.
He's already going to be in your house. Let him sleep in your bed.
Let him sleep in your bed!
but given...
Canteen android.
Given the old David special programming that his crew didn't know about is the information that Walter is run on automatic updates and is hassle-free.
David is hassle-free?
He's a hassle-free companion.
Oh, yeah. Nice. At least he's not a hassle off.
So, yeah. It's,
you got it.
Yeah. May 19th.
Wait a minute. So David is the Fassbender.
Michael Fassbender.
Yeah, now, who's Walter?
He's also Michael Fassbender.
Oh, it's the same model. Yeah. Same looking model.
They don't look like Bilbo Baggins yet.
No.
That comes later.
And they also have the same size of penis.
Interesting.
And then the next thing that you got to watch.
No.
Again, go to YouTube. You're there at your desk right
now. You're not the boss. Oh, he is kind of the boss of me.
And I want you to search Atomic Blonde Red Band.
Okay.
Atomic Blonde is a comic book.
Yeah.
And Charlize Theron has made this movie, and it's coming out July 28th.
What's that about, Carrie?
I will tell you.
Good
Charlie. It's a book from, let's see, she works for MI6 during the Cold War. She's an agent.
It never ended, you know.
Isn't the Cold War?
No.
But I want you to watch this trailer, because the first 30 seconds of it is some of the best fighting on a stairs scenes that I've seen. And Charlize Theron is not only getting her ass kicked, but kicking ass.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, this movie looks really fucking amazing.
Hmm. Nice.
I mean, if you like an action movie.
But she's
the star. She's a spy. They refer to her.
It's a period piece.
It's a period piece. They say that she, you know, is one of the best spies in the world, an impressive set of skills, and they have an assignment for her. And another good thing about it is that it's directed by David Leitch, who is going to be directing Deadpool 2.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
I will in 2 weeks when I get out of Ghost in the Shell be able to tell you whether or not anybody's ever going to make a live action anime adaptation that's worth a shot.
I know we talked about being nervous about Power Rangers. I'm really fucking nervous about Ghost in the Shell.
Because Ghost in the
Another
Shell
one I
is,
just don't care about.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat.
I'm curious. Really? I'm curious.
Ghost in the Shell I'm curious, but I have no expectations.
I've watched Ghost in the Shell.
It's one of the best. I mean, right up there with Cowboy Bebop as far as best science fiction stories ever told.
Yep.
No,
on sci-fi?
Any medium.
Yeah.
One of the best sci-fi stories ever told. And it's fascinating because they kind of get into what would happen if we become more of a cyborg interface, mm-hmm. what terrorism is going to look like when people can actually commit terrorism without leaving the house, you know, without... Sure. Physical terrorism without leaving the house, you know, jacking into machines and all kinds of other shit. It's a phenomenal piece of work that's spanned 20 some odd years now. Mm. And if they do it right, it's going to be amazing. It's going to be transformative. It'll probably fail miserably like Fifth Element did. But
Was Fifth Element considered a failure?
It bombed.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Just since it came out.
It's funny you bring that up, though, because the other one that I'm nervous about is the one...
And that's the one I'm not nervous about. With Valerian.
Valerium.
Yeah. Yeah.
The City of a Thousand Planets.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense, Valerian.
Shit. I think it's
but that's one issue. That's one issue of a comic that ran for almost 40 years with the same writer and illustrator.
Well, I hope they try to put all the stories into that one
They're
movie.
They're not going to. But we're talking, okay, everything that was great about Fifth Element was lifted from the Valerian comics.
Hmm.
And actually, Jabba's Palace was lifted from Valerian. There's so much, like, they finally translated them into English, so I have three or four of the graphic novels from the 70s.
Isn't it French?
It's French.
I don't care.
And these are guys that inspired Mobius. You know, it's they're phenomenal.
I think I know the answer for most.
Moby?
I want to put this
sucks.
On the table.
Shh.
Because I've said now what two or three movies I'm nervous about. I mean, uh-huh. It's not that I'm denying them. I'm
sad that they're all sci-fi.
Well, no, yeah. I mean, they could be great. What is the next movie coming out that you're not nervous about? At all. You're just going to walk in there and say, fuck it.
Guardians?
Yeah, Guardians.
That's what I think.
That thing looks like...
But that's a proven
formula.
That shit's
firing on...
No, they've already had test screenings where they rate them, you know, they rank them, and Marvel has this procedure that they do, and...
11 out of 10.
No, 100. They score...
11 out of 10, 100?
Yeah.
Well,
100. This is the first time that they've had a movie score 100.
Really?
And they compared it to other Marvel movies that they tested with this same formula that they do. And, you know, like the first Iron Man was like 90, you know?
Mm-hmm.
This one, 100.
You know why,
well,
right?
Well, I'll tell you why. It's because the director is committed and loves the franchise.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody involved loves the franchise. And it's...
I know the right answer.
I've been...
You're missing it.
What?
It's Kurt Russell's beard.
Kurt Russell. Yeah, throw the fucking Kurt Russell up in that motherfucker.
I've been purposefully avoiding the trailers for that movie. Because not only do I not want the action scenes spoiled, but the jokes.
Yeah.
And I feel like they aren't going to have a funnier joke than I saw in the one trailer before Logan, I think.
Where
Drax and the Antenna Girl and Peter Quill.
Her name is fucking Mantis. Sir.
Her name's Antenna Girl. they're sitting there, and they make a joke, and Drax makes a joke, and I was laughing so hard.
Know this.
I hope there's a funnier joke.
James
than
Gunn
that.
Said that some of those scenes are not in the movie.
Oh, right. That would be so good.
Yeah. But like, here's
because
the thing,
that
like,
they're gonna Rogue One it.
If you see that trailer, that scene, because she reads minds.
Yeah.
And she reads feelings. And that scene when she reads Peter Quill's feelings and the things Drax says after that,
his sexual desire.
God.
I can't wait
so
to see the
funny.
Interactions between two. Imaginary fucking characters. I cannot wait to see fucking Rocket being dad.
Oh,
to
baby
Groot.
Groot. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I cannot fuck. Oh my god, you guys! Anyway, go ahead.
Anyway, so
I'm worried
that.
About it.
I can't wait to
well,
see that.
He's like, I'm not gonna like it.
We
I'm the hipster guy on this
you're
show.
Too
now.
Serious.
Oh yeah, I'm the edgy hipster on this show.
We want to get to the
whatever snapback.
We want to get to Jimmy's Kong Skull Island review coming up.
Right, mine too.
But before we do, I have some bad news and some good news.
Why are you looking at me? Every time you say bad news, you look at me.
No, the good news is for you. Actually.
Okay,
that's great. Bad news for me. It's always bad news for me.
Supergirl still wonderful.
Probably bad news.
The bad news for you, Shannon.
Green Lantern lovers
is that James Cameron has pushed back Avatar yet again.
Oh man!
God damn it! I want to watch some more of that blue bullshit.
I already bought my tickets to Orlando to go check out the land.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing is that he's pushed it back to 2018 now. But if you want to know how the Avatar saga ends, apparently the Pandora world of Avatar is a great big spoiler.
Oh, good.
I just want to drop a bunch.
I don't give one fuck about any of these.
Because the park experience, he says, takes place 5 years after the last movie.
Well, that's a good idea.
So,
yeah, fucking idiot.
If somebody told me that, hey Lee, you've got like a week to live, you've got some terminal disease, I would get on a plane, I would go to Orlando, I would go to that exhibit, that experience with about 30 hits of LSD in my system.
Well,
and a machete.
You'd be better off
then go at night.
Well, here's what I hope.
No, you'd be better off on the rock and roll roller coaster with Aerosmith.
Here's what I hope. I hope more fucking idiots that are like so sad that they can't live in Avatar world go there and fucking kill themselves.
I just hope that they sell wigs with prehensile ponytails that double as
sex organs.
As sex organs, yeah. Yes.
Oh,
so I'll tell you what, people
fucking those big animals, right? Fucking their pets.
Isn't that weird?
If you belong to an Avatar cult that you want to commit mass suicide, please
just do it, please.
No, just let me know when I find out I have a terminal disease. We'll hook
get
up.
Together.
But here's to meet that end.
But here's the good news.
Okay,
especially for you, Lee.
Especially for me.
Must be Star Wars.
James Cameron died yesterday
because I know you love 000 and BT.
Yes,
I was right.
They are Darth Vader's astromech and his not protocol droid.
You're getting action figures of them.
Yes.
Now they're $80 a set, but they're really nice looking.
Are they Black Series?
They are Kobe. How do you say
Kobe?
That?
It's the Japanese company.
Kotobukiya.
Kotobuyoka.
Is it two figures in a set?
Yeah.
Yes. Are they both made of $40 bills? Because that would be very nice.
No, they're... those figures are phenomenal. They've got like 1,000 points of articulation.
Yeah, they are. They're really amazing.
And that means...
1,000 points of articulation is just a blob of silly putty.
That means that BT will come with all of the weapons.
Oh.
Speaking of action figures...
Mm-hmm.
I haven't been buying toys for a really long time.
Now that they're $1,000 each?
Yeah, exactly. But I am obsessed with the Lego Batman minifig blind packs.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And I've got a shout out to the kids at the Sev, right? Jimmy and I need a goddamn Lego Batman, and I've got some traits. If you're listening to this and you've got an extra death metal Batman.
Why in the world would the kids at the Sev be listening to this?
It's fuck. I hope they're not listening to this. but at the school, I'm like, hey, who's?
Shout out as in you've already traded with them and they're doing a good job.
Well, no, what Antonio was like. My mom said I couldn't trade Mr. B. I was
like, no way.
I was like, oh, that's so bad.
I wanted
report cards this week.
Fail.
I wanted one. I wanted one specific one out of a blind pack, and that's the one I got.
Ooh,
what'd you get?
Which one?
The one with the ducky floaty ring. And
that's
the
a good one.
See, I want that one too, but I got the fairy wings one. Yep. That's good too.
Kong Skull Island.
Oh!
Yeah.
Jimmy going to review it now, and then I'm going to tell you about what's happening with it next.
Ooh.
Okay, first of all, we haven't had a King Kong movie in...
Since Peter Jackson.
Peter Jackson.
12 years?
95?
Yeah. 2005.
Yeah, 2005.
2005.
And this is a very different Kong movie.
Well, because the production studio Switch Legendary went over to Warner Brothers, and they've got Godzilla, and if you saw Godzilla, was it Matt Reeves, I believe, did Godzilla? His Godzilla is about the size of a skyscraper.
Yeah.
Huge mungus.
And so we need a new Kong.
Yeah.
And so what we get is a new Kong in the sense of John Goodman and his, you know, crack team
Ragtag
of scientists.
Crew.
They believe that they found an island via satellite that has never been touched but may contain monsters.
So this is modern day.
Vietnam.
It's Vietnam period.
About the 70s.
Okay.
Because
we had satellites then, right? Okay.
Not good ones compared to nowadays, but good enough. And before we actually meet John Goodman, all then we actually meet a very young John C. Reilly, not played by John C. Reilly, but a World War II pilot who crashes on the island along with a Japanese pilot as well. And so when John Goodman gets an escort from the military, led by Samuel L. Jackson. Also with Tom Hiddleston, who's basically a mercenary.
Who's not in this movie?
And well,
everyone's in this movie.
Exactly.
Oh, it's got
also
a great cast.
Brie,
it's
Brie
got
Larson. You've got Captain Marvel, Nick Fury, Loki.
Loki.
Yeah.
And then he's a Nova. He's a Nova Corps.
Nova Corps.
Right. But and there's also like just all these great character actors in it, too.
He'll always be Dr. Brule to me.
It's a big monkey.
No, and he like honestly, he kind of plays that character.
Yes,
in this movie, I mean, he really does.
Get out of here, you dingus!
Dingus is dingus.
He wears a bomber jacket on the back that says, "This is for your health."
Good for your health.
Good
no
for your
way.
Health. Yeah, for, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So call it a dracket. Dracket.
Dracket.
So they obviously find John C. Reilly on this island, and he's like, all right, you need to realize the rules of this island, and that Kong is king, and he's a good king. Kind of keeps to himself.
Yeah.
He minds his own business every once in a while.
The order of the fucking island.
He actually got health care for everybody.
He's a good king.
So what they did, though, is they said seismic rockets to basically figure out the lay of the land. What Goodman was trying to do was to wake him up, to wake up the monsters that live beneath. And Kong's not too goddamn happy about it.
See, they're dropping all these bombs on Skull Island.
So your first, I'm trying not to give away too much.
Spoilers.
But your opening scene of them going in is straight out of fucking Apocalypse Now.
Helicopters going in. Complete with that CCR music.
Oh, yeah. I mean, great soundtrack.
That fucking soundtrack is amazing.
And you've got them flying. You've got, you know, these great time-lapse photos where you can see the blades of the helicopters, like, you know, spinning, like, you know,
you've
slow motion.
Run through the jungle.
And then all of a sudden you see this fucking tree just coming right towards one of the, like, from inside the cockpit.
Throwing, like a spear or
yeah,
something?
Yeah, that's in the trailer.
Like, yeah, and just bam! Like that. And you're like, oh, shit! Like, and then I will say I probably said, oh, shit. 30 times, maybe 40,
nice.
In the sense that not even just Kong. There's giant ants. There's
giant spiders.
There's
giant water buffaloes.
What else do you call them? Skull crawlers? Where the
skull
hell?
Skull crawlers? How, where the fuck those are?
How big is this island that no one's ever seen before?
20 feet.
Big island. They explain it. First of all, it's great that it was back in the 70s, right? Because it's like all surrounded by like
a storm system.
Storm system.
Yeah.
That's perpetually in motion.
And actually, like, watching just the helicopters getting through the storm system,
huh.
You're like, oh, fuck.
Hmm.
This is a Kong like you have never seen him before.
And I love
him. But what I like about it, and I get with the Kong franchise, is, yeah, he's murdering you, but you kind of fucking deserve it. Like,
right. King Kong is always doing the right thing.
It's what John C. Reilly says. You came into his house and dropped a bomb. You're looking for a fight.
Right.
And he's fucking pissed, so yeah, he's going to knock the shit out of you.
I love King Kong.
Now let's
show
check
him
it out.
If you show him respect, he's got it back for you.
King Kong is one of my favorite things on the... Like, one of my favorite, like, concepts ever. I was blown away by this movie.
Yeah.
Like, Rich Bonaducci was making fun of me. And he's still making fun of me on Facebook because I either was just sitting there with my mouth, like, just, like, dropped.
I believe the word you're looking for is a gape.
Gape. Mm-hmm. Yes. Or I was going, oh! Woo! It was so fucking good. I love that.
It's one of those ones where another friend of ours, I don't want to name drop because I don't mean to, like, insult him. But
name drop.
No, he brought his little girl to it, and Kat was like, oh my God, she's going to have nightmares. Like, there's some shit in
pretty
there.
Intense.
It's
I'm talking like mouse impaled by insect
giant
legs
spider legs.
Like horrifying images.
Yeah, parents know their kids.
Well, he didn't know. Yeah. What I'm saying is because it's PG-13, it's not Logan R in the sense, but it's got a lot of imagery that I think kids should not see.
It's so fucking great.
And it's intense, and it's fun. I will say the director gets a little too artsy-fartsy with the fucking cinematography. If you had a drinking game where every time Tom Hiddleston is standing still and the camera's like rotating around him while...
Well, he's beautiful. Why wouldn't he do that?
while CCR plays, you'd be drunk in about 40 minutes.
Oh.
But no, I really enjoyed
it.
So
what do you give it?
I'm at 3.5 out of 4.
3.5
out of 4. Dude, I'm giving it fucking 5 out of 4.
5 out of 4.
I love it.
Nice.
Well, if you liked that.
Oh, and stay through the credits.
Yes, I was going to say there is an end scene.
Yeah.
I've got
Marvel style.
I've got what it is, but I'm not going to tell you.
What it be?
So good. Like, if you like King Kong, go see this fucking movie.
Then get ready for first of all, we're getting another Godzilla.
Yep. Yeah.
We're getting Godzilla King of the Monsters. And they have just put together a writer's room for Godzilla versus Kong.
Yeah. That's the thing that John C. Reilly...
He's so fucking giant.
He's so big, but even John C. Reilly says in the movie,
mm-hmm.
He's getting bigger. Yeah. He's like, we don't, you know, you don't mess with Kong. Like, yeah. And as we are here,
and
he's
like the
bigger.
Last one left of his kind. There was bunch of, oh my God. It's
they
guys,
showed his parents.
It's so good. There's so much mythology. It's so fucking.
Oh, well, then there's going to be an origin comic book.
I hope
Kong.
I don't care. I want to see a movie.
I hope when they do Kong versus Godzilla that they do a Japanese version and an American version like they did back in the 60s.
Yeah.
Because in that, Godzilla won in Japan and Kong won in the U.S. Well, so obviously men in suits.
They've got Terry Rossio, who's heading the writer's room. You've also got the guys who wrote Star Trek Beyond.
They did a good job.
You've got the guys who worked on King Killer Chronicles. You've got...
What? The book?
Currently adapting the King Killer Chronicles
okay.
for Lionsgate.
I was confused.
And J. Michael Straczynski's in there.
Oh, he's good.
I like some of his stuff a lot.
A whole bunch of people.
He's either awesome or super shitty.
Yeah.
A whole bunch of people. Anyway, so there you go. You're going to get that coming your way.
If you like giant...
Things.
Monsters fucking punching shit...
What? Wait.
This is your movie.
I'm in it 100%. I'm in it 100% just for the cast.
Do I?
Oh, the cast is ridiculous. And actually, I will say, I think it's one of my favorite Sam Jackson performances.
Oh yeah. Oh, one more thing to look at while you're on YouTube. I got another assignment for you. Go there and search for King Kong on Fire.
Oh, because he's on fire in the movie, too.
No, they this was a 16-foot replica of Kong for the Vietnam premiere.
Yeah.
And they're up on a stage, and there's the giant Kong that's behind them, kind of moving around. And down below, they have, like, these fire dancers.
It caught fire.
And it caught fire.
Whoa.
Oh, geez. Well, that's great, because he actually is. There's a point in the movie where King Kong's on fire fucking punching people.
So... Go look for that video.
Can you help me? I don't remember if I like giant things punching things.
No, you do.
You fucking love it.
You like
it
a lot. You're
going to love this fucking movie.
I told somebody, I said, watching Nick Fury tell the upcoming Captain Marvel when she said, we need to work with Kong. And he goes, bitch, please.
The statement from the Warner Brothers rep about the flaming Kong. Said, there was a small... It wasn't small. There was a small fire in an outdoor atrium at CGV Cinema in Ho Chi Minh City during Kong Skull Island opening event. We're very grateful no one was hurt.
Yeah. I'll bet they are.
It was not a small fire. All right. Let's see. Movies, games. What do we got? And then we'll get out of here.
I got movies.
I got games.
Let's see.
What?
He doesn't have games.
Passengers is now out.
Yeah.
Jennifer Lawrence and Chris Pratt and their space pods.
Yeah. I hear that the blooper reel is actually what you want to watch.
I hear Jennifer Lawrence
is
a real girl and she eats.
Yeah.
Oh. Fences is now out. Denzel Washington.
Yeah.
Mm.
Collateral Beauty with Will Smith.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Good movie. The foreign language film L is now out. That was nominated.
So good.
Firestarter.
Oh, man. What a good movie.
I'm a Firestarter. Is it the story of fucking that German music band?
No, it's Drew Barrymore.
Oh, okay.
No, this is the story about a lady who grows up to become a flesh-eating cannibal back when she was a fire starter.
I'm a fire starter.
Okay.
Fire starter.
Also on Blu-ray is Red Dawn, the original one.
The original?
Such a good movie. Mm. So good.
So not good, bad.
That's Patrick Swayze. He's in that.
And Charlie Sheen.
Huh? Yeah, yeah.
Don't forget Tiger Blood.
Oh, they're great.
What
at
is it? What?
Sheen. I like when the Russians come and kill their teacher.
I think that's it, except for Chip season 5.
That's so good.
I'm actually kind of that's another
Shannon,
one.
Shannon, wait for the box set. Don't buy the season.
Hey, guess what movie looks like a flaming piece of shit.
I think it.
Even when I was a kid, Gary,
I'm not.
I would watch Chips and go, "This is fucking stupid. I'm gonna watch it." Because I think Eric Estrada's great. But fuck everything around Eric Estrada.
Listen, you don't know until you go back and watch the episode where Eric Estrada delivered a baby on a disco dance floor and then danced the night away after.
I don't know because I remember it.
You don't
perfectly.
Know. You don't know until you go back.
Fucking, and like the morning before, there was a 17 fucking pile crash up.
It was
on
terrible.
The goddamn freeway.
You don't know until you go back and watch the episode where Michael Dorn explains slam dancing in the locker room.
That's right.
Worf?
Yeah, Worf was the fucking
Worf
black
was on chips.
He was the guy that would show up in the squad car to cart the people away.
Don't give the black guy a fucking motorcycle.
No, because you realize the inherent flaw in a show about motorcycle cops. What do they do with the perps? Other than kill them and hide the bodies.
Well, I thought that's what they did.
You put him in the car with Worf.
Huh. Worf comes and picks him up. Right. You know, Worf's like,
oh, good job, Ponch and John.
I'm not a very merry man.
That makes perfect sense.
I've got a Zorch.
Going back to Nervous Movies, I think it might be okay.
I think that the 3-minute trailer had 3 minutes and 45 seconds worth of your dick touch my lips jokes.
Yeah.
That was 45 seconds more than the trailer.
Yeah. No, it's when seriously, when you're putting together your trailer with funny people.
Yeah.
And you keep relying on slightly homophobic jokes to try to sell your movie.
I'm just hoping for like a 21 Jump Street.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
When you picked me up, your mouth touched my penis.
So?
Is that funny?
Yes.
It's never funny when we do it.
Well, no.
It's like super serious.
I am so hard to lift.
Because the other one that's like that is Baywatch, which I think does look good.
Well, it's The Rock.
All right.
Games.
For the Nintendo Switch.
Tetris.
This week.
Is that a thing?
The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus.
Afterbirth? Yuck.
Wow.
You need to check out that game.
It's an
indie game.
It's another birth horror tentacle indie game.
Kind of, yeah.
Best Buy has been on Nintendo Switch wipes.
It's really good. They're weird.
Yeah, Scary Spice does all the voices.
This one's called...
Midwife.
Sorry. This is a Nier Automata.
Sure.
Automata? I don't know how you want to say it. But
what's it about?
This is a game by Platinum Games. Oh. Well, this is coming out for PC this week. It already came out for consoles.
So good.
What's it about?
It's you play a thing that fights stuff.
What's it?
Wow, star- that's like a every lady, game.
A lady.
Game ever. Okay.
Yeah.
What's cool. its star sign?
Cool. But I don't. What's a star sign? Wow. Like zodiac star?
Good yeah. morning,
I don't know.
Star sign.
But it has like every kind of game you could think of inside one game. The game starts off and it's an over the top space shooter like the old games,
mm-hmm. yeah.
and then it switches to a side one, and then at some point it becomes a 2D side scroller with a person that you jump around with. And then another time the camera comes out and it's a 3D fighting game. Like it's
I don't think it's kind of like
is there any point where you're rolling up stuff?
Yeah, I want to know.
I don't think there's any rolling up. It's not like
Katamari Damacy.
No, it's not Katamari. Okay.
At any point do I crush candy?
I don't think there's any crushing.
Is there
of
any
candy.
Point where I build burgers?
Yes.
Oh.
Is there any point where you actually answer trivia questions?
No.
Is there any point where you slide root beers down
a
bar?
Like video game questions.
I don't think you guys want to play this game.
Do I ever eat mushrooms and become bigger?
No, it's not Mario.
Yeah,
do you ever jump about and you're just like a one snouted thing that has to look out for like
Are you talking about
Hubert?
Hubert?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you ever have to dig with a shovel and hope that monsters
and
don't
like
eat
maybe
you?
And pump them
you're
up?
You're talking
and
Dig Dug.
Yeah.
No Dig Dug.
Okay.
Do you ever ride
an
ostrich?
Game. It doesn't have every goddamn game I can think
of.
That's
a type of game.
Do you ever ride besides an ostrich with like a jousting?
Yeah. Do you ever like joust on a
joust?
I wasn't sure.
Do you ever get guns dropped on you while the Peter Gunn theme plays?
Oh, they might do that.
Is there ever a giant caterpillar that's trying to kill you?
I'm gonna just turn your microphone off.
Is there ever a moment where the gaming segment ends?
No. It goes. Professional Farmer 2017.
Boom! I wish Jay was here.
For the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. Yeah.
It takes place in 2029.
That looks pretty great.
They're like, where are all our workers?
The corn's coming in. Goodness, yeah.
I lived that game. It's not very fun.
It's not fun?
No.
And then, do you guys remember Turok 2 from the N64?
Yeah. No, but I remember Turok 4.
The Dinosaur
4.
Hunter, right?
Yeah, the Dinosaur Hunter. They're remaking that for the PC.
Oh,
They're taking the old game and just kind of making it look a little better and re-releasing
it
for cheap.
I hope this one actually finally answers the mystery of what happened to Turok's dad.
Yeah. That wasn't until Turok 4.
We all want that.
Yeah. I'm just excited for that first that farmer's game. The first level is where you have to go knock a hole in the wall. So they can all get through and get back to business.
Oh, I thought you were talking about.
Wait a minute.
The first level's like, I just gotta build me a house.
I hope some salesman doesn't.
I gotta get me some slaves.
Now, I know how this game goes. Because like the second level, you're like, I hope some vacuum cleaner salesman don't come diddle my wife while I'm going.
Or
Or my daughter.
Or my daughter. Or my other daughter.
None of that matters, though.
I'm sick of these jokes being made about me, being popularly circulated.
None of that matters because Zelda Breath of the Wild on the Switch or the Wii U is mind-numbingly awesome.
That's what I hear.
I picked it up on the Switch, and I got a Switch, and it is... It's really cool.
Are you happy with your Switch other than Zelda?
Well, I don't use it for anything else besides Zelda. It's a Zelda machine.
I've watched Egg play it, and I was like, oh, this looks like a video
game. This looks like Legend of Zelda.
But it's not, though, because it's open world.
Yeah, but I didn't know that the Breath of the Wild is the Breath of Olivia Wild.
Oh.
It makes it a whole
different game. I'll watch that.
She guest stars. Yeah. She guest stars.
As the Breath.
It's a pretty cool game, though.
Cool.
That's it. That's all we got. All
right. Let me know about the Switch once you get another game. Because that's what I'm hearing, is that it's a Zelda machine.
Oh, it is. Right now, it's a Zelda machine.
Yeah.
That's how it always works. Right? One really good game.
Well, there's 9 games?
Yeah.
No, 10 if you count that other one that you just announced.
Well, yeah, because after Zelda, the best game is The Binding of Isaac Afterbirth Plus.
Yeah, for Switch.
Afterbirth.
But that's what I'm hearing, is that those other games are...
And that's like being a doula? Like you're a doula?
Sure.
No, you actually play the fetus.
Yeah, you're a part of a pair of dueling doulas.
It was born. What? It's a really weird game.
It's
fucking God damn it, Nintendo, get your shit together.
Well, this game's been out for years on PC and Xbox One and
very
PS4.
Popular.
It's very popular
in the
indie games.
Well, people are
I like the mods. I like to develop mods for it. I like to give them costumes.
Okay. Mr. B, if you will.
I'm just going to say, if you're going to eat more ham, you need to do that shit on Friday night.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.